Hi, I'm Daniel Rakita, and in this talk, I will be discussing work I did alongside my co-authors Bilge, Mutlu, and Michael Gleicher at the University of Wisconsin-Madison on the effects of delays in a mimicry-control teleoperation system. Teleoperation systems afford people the ability to project their manipulations into remote, dangerous, or high-precision settings, such as for underwater exploration, surgeries, or even remotely treating patients during a virus outbreak. Throughout this work, we investigate and characterize a teleoperation paradigm called mimicry control, where a user demonstrates how the robot should move with their own arm motions, and the robot reflects these motions as best as possible in real time. We presented this method at HRI in 2017. Over the past several years, other systems have built upon or utilized the motion remapping ideas behind a mimicry control interface. These systems have demonstrated the exciting potential mimicry control interfaces have for scenarios such as remote home care or disaster relief. However, further investigation is required in order to characterize how certain aspects of this new interface in turn affect task performance. For example, all practical teleoperation systems have some amount of delay, where there is some temporal gap between when the user provides an input and the robot reflects a corresponding output. While delays have been investigated in many standard teleoperation interfaces in prior work, it is unclear how delays affect the immersive, tightly coupled motor control loop in a mimicry control interface. So, to this end, our current work addresses the following central research questions. How do delays affect mimicry control performance? And, perhaps more interestingly, how do these delays affect motor input strategies during mimicry control teleoperation? Here is an overview for the rest of this talk that will address these research questions, and we'll start with the different types of delays that we investigated. We assessed two different types of delays in our work: onset latency delays, and robot slowness delays. An onset latency delay consists of the robot starting its motion output some fixed interval after the user's input command. A robot slowness delay consists of the robot lagging behind the user's motion inputs because the user's arm is physically faster than the robot arm, as dictated by the robot's joint velocity limits. For details on how we implemented a certain slowness delay given a desired time interval, please see our paper. Here are the two types of delays side by side. Note that even though the source of delay is different here, the end result is the same, that being that the robot gets to its end pose 750 milliseconds behind. We will now discuss our user study. Our user study investigated two central hypotheses. First, that task performance and user perceptions will decrease as delays increase, which is strongly supported by prior work. And second, that people will exhibit different strategies for adapting to delays, either in response to different amounts and types of delays, or due to individual differences in participants. To investigate these hypotheses, our study used the following physical setup. A user stood behind a Sawyer robot and controlled its motions using an HTC Vive motion controller. We recorded the robot's motions through its encoder data, and we also optically recorded the robot's end effector position using an HTC Vive tracker. This redundant motion data allowed us to ensure accurate time alignment between the robot's encoders and the optical motion capture system throughout our analyses. Using the setup, participants performed three tasks under numerous delay conditions: a toy cleanup task, a stirring task, and a tracing task. Using our motion recording setup, here's an example of what our output data looks like on the tracing task. We could also assess the robot's end effector trace, as well as the user's hand trace, compared to the reference paths. Each participant performed all three tasks under 7 different delay conditions. 250, 500, and 750 millisecond delays due to both onset latency and robot slowness, as well as a base condition without any added delay. For reference, this base condition had 80 milliseconds of total delay. Condition order was randomized between participants for each task. We recruited 21 participants for our study, and along with motion data, also collected the following objective and subjective measures for each condition per task. For a comprehensive view of all of our results, please see our paper. But in this talk, I'll just report on this subset of objective and subjective measures. The following objective measures showed that there was a significant decrease in performance for the onset latency conditions compared to the base condition across all tasks. However, the robot slowness conditions did not exhibit this same performance degradation. And the following subjective measures back up these results, indicating that participants perceived onset latency delays to be significantly more detrimental to performance, effortful, and frustrating compared to robot slowness delays. So, coming back to hypothesis 1, this was only partially supported, as this degradation seems to only apply to onset latency delays and not robot slowness delays. Thus, coming back to hypothesis 2, our premise was that there must be some motor input strategy that participants were adopting for robot slowness delays that allowed them to be resilient to even significant delays, while no successful adjustment strategy was exhibited to overcome onset latency delays. Our goal was to uncover these motor input adjustment strategies in a subsequent analysis. We proposed 2 motion analysis approaches in this work. In this talk, we will describe one of these approaches, called the velocity ratio test. The velocity ratio test divides the translation velocity signal of the user's hand position by the translation velocity of the robot's end effector to derive a new signal that we call the velocity ratio signal. Values above 1 in this signal mean that the user's hand was moving faster than the robot's end effector at this time, and vice versa. Using the velocity ratio signal, we take the ratio of points above 1.3, the ratio of points between 0.7 and 1.3, and the ratio of points below 0.7, and stack these values into a single 3-dimensional point called a velocity ratio point. Note that this procedure took this whole control interaction between the robot and user and distilled it down to just a single point that we can now aggregate with other points and analyze. Here are all the velocity ratio points plotted for all tasks, conditions, and participants. For onset latency delays, the points tended toward the point 0.5, 0.1, 0.4, with more delay added, meaning that participants tended to oscillate between moving faster and slower than the robot, making for a start and stop strategy. For robot slowness delays, the points tended toward the point 0.9, 0.1, 0, the more delay was added, meaning that participants tended to move much faster than the robot, making for a motion exaggeration strategy. Note that this means that people do not slow down their motion to match the slow robot as one may expect, but instead speed up their motion to displace the excess time with larger input paths. And these strategies match what we see in our motion data, where this user exhibited a start and stop strategy, though was unsuccessful in tracing the letters with more delay added. And this user exhibited a motion exaggeration strategy to successfully trace the letters even when more delay was added. So, to wrap up with an overall discussion, we have a few takeaway points from our work. First, in the case of mimicry control, users tend to adopt a motion exaggeration strategy to successfully overcome even considerable amounts of robot slowness delay. And while users tend to use a start and stop strategy in the case of onset latency delays, this strategy does not prevent significant degradation in task performance and user perceptions. And more broadly, for all teleoperation interfaces, it is important to look at the source of delays during performance assessments as our work shows that different types of delays can lead to vastly different performance and perception outcomes. And with that, thanks so much for watching.